Good morning, friends. It's 4:10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, December 13th, supposedly 2016. And yeah, it's early. It is early. And I've been up for 2 hours now already. I fell asleep on the couch and I just want to admit right now that, yeah, I do normally get up between 2 and 4 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. For those of you out there who have really small children, you understand that you really got to go out of your way to get that special quiet time. And depending on your child, how rambunctious they might be, you might really value that time. Now, my wife uses the time after he goes to bed to do her studying and all that, because she's in school and everything, or her sewing, because she's been learning how to sew, and I think she's doing a great job, because she's awesome. But I use the morning time. So I would say that my son and I actually have the same bedtime. And I don't know. I probably never would have thought that would be the case 10 years ago, really. But so is life. You know, our bodies start to break down. And in this culture and in this atmosphere and environment, all of us have to work very hard, especially if we are determined to allow for our wives to be able to stay home with our children and give them care and take care of them and educate them, because we don't want the wicked state and their wicked schools that do nothing but indoctrinate and pervert the minds of our children to sink their dirty claws into them. It's difficult. And I'm not going to just say that all you need is a devotion to hard work. You do. You need faith. You need faith in God above, that if you are doing all things in order to please Him and hold on to what's right, even in the face of a society that says all things that are polar opposites to His word, first off, you can count on the fact that it is He who has given you these desires. And again, you can count on the fact that He will help you fulfill His goodwill. So I'm encouraging everyone, keep at it. Keep at it. If you're determined to do His will, He will make a way. And if oftentimes it is very difficult, well, that's the thing. There's no guarantees that life is going to be easy, and there is zero guarantees that living a life that seeks to honor our God and Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, is going to be easy. But it is rich and fulfilling, and I would not have it any other way. Believe me, I've lived every other way. And even until a year and a half, 2 years ago, there was still so much of a cloud of deceit in my mind and scales over my eyes. And I rejoice every day that I get up and I can experience the true God and Creator of us and this creation and everything. I can experience Him through His Son, because He chose to give me so much grace and mercy, so much favor in our Lord Jesus Christ. And he is to be honored. So I hope everybody likes the graphic I came up with on my screen. I couldn't find in a Google image search something that seemed more appropriate to some of the stuff that I'm going to talk about today. So this is the idea, though. This is the idea. It is never, ever a good place for the church to be where it is right now with the state. Ever. Unfortunately, the Bible colleges that are cranking out hireling contract pastors left and right and not doing it for free are allowing them to neglect our history, the history of the world since the first century. They're allowing them to either forget about all of the evils that are caused when the church and the state join together in an unholy union, or they're actually teaching them that that is part of acceptable church history. Guys like James White has that sort of opinion. You have to understand, there's so much to your eschatology that dictates the way that you look at all of the events of history from the first century forward. If you are a preterist, you are going to look at all of the history that occurred after that as a natural progression of the church. You would look at things like the councils of Rome starting in the time of Constantine. And you would look at those things as, well, this is just natural, organic church history, and you will give it some kind of validation in the sphere of what should be considered as actual, real church history, as opposed to the history of the forming of the apostasy and the man of sin and the predecessor to the little horn of Daniel, the Antichrist. If you're a futurist, you might even have a more pacifist view towards that history. You may not know it whatsoever. A lot of futurists don't. A lot of futurists, not all, a lot of futurists have such a terrible grasp on the story of the church since the first century. It is it is mind-boggling, because you have to think, how in the world have they come to an informed decision about their eschatology when they know nothing of the past? It's almost like you almost think that futurists that almost that their name basically indicates their knowledge base, I suppose. They seem to only know what is told to them will be forthcoming. And they seem to know so little about what has brought us to where we are. They're so myopic. And I'm not slamming those people who have been taught futurism and preterism by people they trust. And so that they believe that that is the right way. I'm not doing that. I'm talking about those systems. I was a futurist. I was a futurist for years because that's what I was taught by people I trusted. They didn't even tell me that there were other points of views, alternate points of views concerning prophecy, concerning the way that Revelation could be interpreted or that Daniel could be interpreted. I was presented futurism as this is it, that this is the way. And there's no other way. The Jesuits have done their work. They have done their work. And they have been very effective. And all the blame doesn't go on them. Futurism still dominates the eschatology of the church at large. And it doesn't have to. It dominates the church at large because most people who would identify themselves as futurists have no idea why. They have not taken the time away from their own selfish endeavors to look into whether or not these things may be so. They have so much of a prejudice against people like Seventh-day Adventists that they won't even share in a dialogue with them. Many of them are just willfully ignorant. And then what is emerging today, besides the fact that many people out there are trying to replace futurism, because a lot of people are seeing the cracks in that system. Now there are many out there that are actively seeking to replace futurism as an eschatology with preterism. Preterism far more scholarly than futurism, but just as full of holes. And the people who are not being actively indoctrinated from futurism to preterism are the ones who fall into the camp of, well, what does it matter? We can't understand it. And there are even those out there who have been charged as leaders, either by contract or by conscience, who push this mentality. What does it matter? It's a distraction from the gospel. I'm not kidding. They really think that. It's not a distraction from the gospel. It is key. Prophecy is key in the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. The testimony of Jesus Christ is the spirit of prophecy. Don't ever let anybody tell you, it's not important. It's not important to how we live today. So don't worry about it. We can't understand it. Nonsense. That's nonsense. And it is important. One of the most important things about it, there's many, is how we view the ecumenical movement. You know, a lot of people out there that are still in relatively conservative church organizations who would tell you that ecumenism and the ecumenical movement is bad, they don't have much of a reason for it being bad. You know, with them, it's just, well, because it's bad. Well, because why is it bad? Because it's bad. Well, yeah, but I mean, what is it specifically about it, this ecumenical movement or the evangelical church moving more and more towards agreement with, say, Roman Catholicism? What about that is bad? Well, it's just bad because they're Roman Catholics. I see they don't have a sense of urgency against these things because they don't have a sense of their own history. Because they have been fed the lie that Revelation and Daniel are very hard to understand. Or they're impossible to understand. Well, it takes some work, but they're not impossible to understand. And there are many alive today teachers who can expound on these things and can help us to understand these things. There's a great wealth of literature out there that can help us to understand the historicist perspective on Revelation. It is not an ununderstandable book. Why would it say in the first few verses that this book was for the bond servants of Jesus Christ? Unless it was meant for the bond servants of Jesus Christ to understand, to study, to cherish, to meditate on. One of the worst things, and you can hear this from those who really have a great understanding of the evils of dispensational futurism. One of the real horrors of being a futurist, and specifically a dispensational futurist, which most are, is how the church doesn't even really grasp their birthright, type and anti-type, Israel. Who is Israel today? They can't grasp that. They don't understand. So, why would it be any wonder, then, that much of the church is so willing to sell their birthright for a mess of stew? I am going to talk more, as I said in my video yesterday, I'm going to talk more about the problem with 501c3 incorporation. The churches in this country being in bed with the state. Harsh words. And I mean them to be. You know, God doesn't call the church in Revelation 18 the mother of harlots for nothing. God has always considered his people not being true to him as the absolute equivalents of spiritual adultery, fornication, harlotry, being a prostitute. Am I saying that much of the church today is a prostitute? Well, yeah. I could try to get around it. I could try to say things that are nicer. But I don't know that that would be truthful. So before I go into that, I thought that this would be kind of a decent addition. I decided to start going through some YouTube channels that I like or have gotten good information from, and I could share those with you, and hopefully I could get some further comments on these channels if any of you are familiar with them. If you're not, then here's new channels to go check out. Look at what they have. I'm always on the lookout for channels that I am not aware of. Always. So If you guys don't hear a channel, and I'm going to be going through this alphabetically, so today it will be A to C. If you don't hear a channel that you really like within this alphabetization, let me know. I'm always on the lookout for new channels. Absolutely. So here we go. All right. This is my favorite YouTube channels and why. And starting with A through C. Okay, so first, 21st, one God. And that is the number two, the number one, lowercase st, uppercase O, lowercase ne, uppercase G, lowercase OD. No spaces, all one word. 21st, one God. Featuring lectures and discussions by men such as J. Dan Gill, Anthony Buzzard, and Sean Finnegan, this channel provides a look into the Bible from a Unitarian perspective, having come to a point where I have serious doubts about the merits of the doctrine of the Trinity. I find the material here very helpful. Much food for thought. Number two, AJC 1844, all one word, capital A, lowercase JAYCEE. The number 1844, AJC 1844. With his series, Flat Earth Smarts, he gets you thinking a bit. Instead of perhaps jumping to conclusions or writing the next imprudent theory thrown into the fray, if you still think the Gleason map deserves more time to be tested, and I do, you will appreciate his take on the circular map and many other things. Number three, all one word, Aramaic Bible, all in lowercase. Vic Alexander is an author, translator, and student of the Aramaic language. In his videos, he may just challenge many things you think you know about the language of the Bible. Even if you come away disagreeing with Vic, no student of Scripture should ever spend too much time in an echo chamber. It makes us weak. So give Vic a chance, and you might just learn something. Number four, Barry Satoro. And that is two words, capital B-A-R-R-Y, space, capital S, lowercase O-E-T-O-R-O. Barry runs a secular news channel, investigating popular news stories and memes for their veracity and providing plentiful commentary. Barry, along with ODD Reality, were among the first to signal to everyone the entrapping nature of the Pizzagate scandal. He repeatedly encourages others to do good, solid investigation and be ever watchful of this corrupt government. Number five, all one word, Bible or Traditions, capital B, lowercase I-B-L-E, capital O, lowercase R, capital T, lowercase R-A-D-I-T-I-O-N-S. Although many recent videos here seem to be of a partisan nature, which I find highly odd for a biblical historicist, check out his playlist section and you'll find a lot of helpful materials. In particular, the Book of Revelation Prophecy Review is 37 bite-sized videos presenting Revelation from the traditional historicist perspective. Number six, all one word, Chick Tracts, capital C, lowercase H-I-C-K, T-R-A-C-K-T. Hold on. I misspelled that. That would be, go to my YouTube. Because I believe that I just gave you a misspelling, which I kind of have to do because I did. It's not a track. It's a tract with a T. Okay. Yeah, I'm going to change that right on the fly. There we go. File. Save. Very sorry, capital C, lowercase HICKTRACTS. This channel is mostly the vlog of David Daniels, a researcher and longtime member of Chick Publications. You will learn things from David. Whether it be stories of Jack Chick and Alberto Rivera, or dissecting the questionable origins of sciaticus, David is a great presenter of information. Do I agree with all his conclusions? No. But again, remember the echo chamber thing. Number 7. All one word, citizen of the realm. Capital C, lowercase ITIZENOFTHE, capital R, lowercase EALM. This Seventh-day Adventist channel contains some excellent little jewels hidden away inside. Among them, Tainted Vision alone is worth the price of admission. It will make you reconsider all you may have thought concerning the amoral or benign nature of the theater. Although this channel's videos aren't prolific, they are often powerful. Number 8. Two words, conspiracy theorista. Capital C, lowercase O-N-S-P-I-R-A-C-Y space. Capital T, lowercase H-E-O-R-I-S-T-A. Although she hasn't published anything for 10 months now, major sad face, what she did publish is some of the most intelligent critiques of false flags, hoaxes, predictive programming, and 9/11. If you think polite, well-mannered housewives have little to offer in the realm of conspiracy, get ready for a sucker punch. Number 9. Curious Life of a Flat Earther. That is a capital C-U-R-I-O-U-S in lowercase space, capital L in lowercase I-F-E space, lowercase O-E-V space, A space, capital F, lowercase L-A-T space, capital E, lowercase E-A, sorry, lowercase A-R-T-H-E-R, Curious Life of a Flat Earther. As of this morning, this channel is closed. In the wake of the revelation that YouTube is uber willing to censor vital content, this channel closure smells as bad as the globe. I hope he is simply moving and renaming. If anyone has information on this, put it in the comments. Fortunately, channels like Puppet Test Pilot have mirrored some of his content. I highly recommend his angular resolution video to better understand why objects past the horizon get cut off at the bottom. Is it the curve? Well, you'd better find out. So again, any that I missed between the letters of A and C that you think are really great channels that could help quite a bit, please include in the comments below. Now, on to other things. Before I start reading the front page here at hushmoney.org, I want to go over why my wife and I still persist at staying with a church organization that we know is a 501c3, thus we believe is being disobedient. As I said yesterday, I believe oftentimes this is done in ignorance, and we will see from even this site, hushmoney.org, that's oftentimes the case. So the reason we would be staying here could be summed up very well in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which would be the love passage, which for some reason, 50% of the housewives in America alone tend to take this passage, embroider it, frame it, and put it over their toilet bowl tanks. Maybe they think because their husbands spend somewhere around 3-5% of their time standing in front of that toilet bowl tank that eventually this passage will sink in. Who knows? But starting in verse 7, it says that concerning love, that it bears all things, it believes all things, it hopes all things, it endures all things. And this is why we have continued to stay. We are bearing the problems that we see, knowing that we were blind until the Lord opened our eyes. We believe in those there who have a public profession of Christianity. We hope. We hope in the patient, loving kindness of God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the head of the church. And we are doing our prayerful best to endure all the things that we find to be hard to endure. Except for the month of December, because it is nearly unbearable to go into a place said to be the house of God and see the Christmas trees and wreaths, ornaments and decorations of ancient festivals that have nothing to do with Christ and his birth. Besides the fact that Christ never instructed us to celebrate his birth or the birth of anyone, we still endure most weeks sitting there on a Sunday of all days, participating in an activity that only serves to reinforce the unbiblical idea that there is a priest class in the evangelical church, basically just known of as the pastoral staff. We endure that, and we try to endure it patiently. As my wife has pointed out in the past, there are many times when I go there and she says, you're so visibly uncomfortable. You just look angry. And she's probably right. And it's certainly not on purpose. And I completely understand those of you out there who have had such a hard time enduring these things, especially when you gain more and more knowledge of the scriptures and see the contrast between the pure word of God and the very impure traditions of men. I do understand that. And at the same time, I'm going to again And I don't know that it's going to change anytime soon. Encourage every one of you within the sound of my voice to find a body of professing Christians. I know that they're going to do a lot of things that don't sit well, that in some ways even contradict Scripture. Because, for one thing, these same people who are doing these things that we find so contradictory to the Word of God and the worship of this God and His Christ, these people nonetheless have oftentimes done their utmost to be our family. Can we lay charge to them that they have been deceived by the same system that we have? Or should we not patiently, prayerfully, continue on with them as much as we can? Not silently, but speaking the truth in love whenever we're given opportunity. And you can take my word for it, I am not given much opportunity. So if you find yourself in that situation and you think, oh, I'm not doing any good, nobody wants to hear what I have to say, or anything else, well, you're not alone. And it's not all what you say. If you do your best to hang in there, to show these people that you do care for them, that you do love them, then, maybe then, they'll be willing to hear what you have to say. Because there's so much in our actions that speak very loudly. So that is why we continue to endure. And we will continue to endure until we are cast out of that church organization. And then if that's the case, then we will do our best to try to continue the relationships we can with those saints that we have met there, and try to speak the truth to them, to show love to them in any way we can, and perhaps we will find a new church organization to go into, to try to be a part of, to hope and pray that God will do His work there in us and through us. Hushmoney.org. If you go to hushmoney.org and you hit the home tab, you will be brought first to the page that is on the screen. In the matter of changing religion, state favors are stronger than penalties. The framers of America's founding documents relied heavily upon the writings of the political philosopher Baron de Montesquieu. Typical of Montesquieu's brilliant insight, he once wrote that a more certain way to attack religion is by favor, by the comforts of life, by the hope of wealth, not by what reminds one of it, but by what makes one forget it, not by what makes one indignant, but by what makes men lukewarm. When other passions act on our souls, and those which religion inspires are silent, in the matter of changing religion, state favors are stronger than penalties. From The Spirit of the Laws by Baron de Montesquieu, 1748. Acceptance of state favors has had disastrous consequences on the church in America. the church has been effectively silenced, or as Reverend D. James Kennedy put it, gagged. Now the disastrous consequences are being felt by the entire nation. The IRS has succeeded in gagging Christians. Reverend D. James Kennedy has stated, "The federal government has proved a tremendous impediment to the ongoing work of Christians. In all the laws that they have passed against Christian schools, gagging the church, taxation, and all kinds of things that they have done, and they have made it harder for the church to exercise its prerogatives and to preach the gospel." Take the last presidential election. There were numbers of things that I knew that I was never able to say from the pulpit, because if you advance the cause of one candidate or impede the cause of the other, you can lose your tax exemption. That would have been disastrous, not only for the church, but for our school and our seminary. Everything. So you were gagged. You cannot do that. The IRS, a branch of our government, has succeeded in gagging Christians. Is there a remedy? Yes. The church can be re-empowered and regain the former glory and influence she once held in America. But in order to do so, the church must stop acting as an underling, as a subordinate, as a dependent of the state. The church must cease asking for state favors. Because that for his name's sake they went forth, taking nothing of the Gentiles. 3 John 1:7. Rather than being a favor or a benefit, what the church has done through state incorporation and seeking the IRS's 501c3 status is it traded its birthright for a mess of state-licensed pottage. The church has taken the hush money, but there's a way out. The church can give it back. The church can give back the government benefits that no church ever needed in the first place. By spending a little time here, you'll learn some important facts, problems, and myths about the corporate 501c3 status. You'll discover what happens to churches and ministries when they ask for these state favors and operate as, quote, nonprofit tax-exempt religious corporations, unquote. You'll likely learn some things that will shock and amaze you. You'll also learn why it's completely unnecessary for a church to incorporate and become 501c3, and why most of what you've been told about the so-called benefits of incorporation and 501c3, as it applies to churches, is a pack of lies, and that these lies were fabricated by attorneys and accountants to create a multi-billion-dollar church compliance industry. So, accessing information and navigating the site. If you already know the general category of information that you're looking for, you can select from the links on the top left of this page, or you can take a guided tour of this site by clicking the next button at the bottom of the page, which I will be doing. Under the articles link, at the top of this page, you'll find some thought-provoking incorporated 501c3 church articles that have appeared in newspapers and magazines. And there are also a few audio files of radio interviews that have been done on this issue. And yeah, I would definitely recommend that everybody get very familiar with this site. There's a lot of very good information on this site. Now, they just give a list of what you might be looking for in here. They say, are you trying to get reliable facts on whether you should 501c3 a church, 501c3 a ministry, incorporate a church, incorporate a ministry, become tax exempt, become tax deductible, start a nonprofit religious organization? Are you looking for trustworthy information on how to start a church, start a ministry, start a home church, start a free church, empower your church? Would you like all that without having to hire an attorney or CPA? I certainly would. You've come to the right place. And we are going to hit the next button. Oh, look here. Good old LBJ. So, on the page entitled 501c3 Facts, we read, most churches in America have organized as 501c3 tax-exempt religious organizations. This is a fairly recent trend that has only been going on for about 50 years. Churches were only added to Section 501c3 of the tax code in 1954. We can thank Senator Lyndon B. Johnson for that. Johnson was no ally of the church. As part of his political agenda, Johnson had it in mind to silence the church and eliminate the significant influence of the church and always had on shaping public policy. I'm sorry, the influence the church had always had on shaping public policy, because it did. Although Johnson preferred this as a favor to churches, the favor also came with strings attached. They always do. More like shackles. One need not look far to see the devastating effects 501c3 acceptance has had to the church and the consequent restrictions placed upon any 501c3 church. 501c3 churches are prohibited from addressing, in any tangible way, the vital issues of the day. For a 501c3 church to openly speak out or organize in opposition to anything that the government declares legal, even if it is immoral, e.g. abortion, homosexuality, etc., that church will jeopardize its tax-exempt status. The 501c3 has had a chilling effect upon the free speech rights of the church. LBJ was a shrewd and cunning politician who seemed to well appreciate how easily many of the clergy would sell out. Did the church ever need to seek permission from the government to be exempt from taxes? Were churches prior to 1954 taxable? No. Churches have never been taxable. To be taxable, a church would first need to be under the jurisdiction and therefore under the taxing authority of the government. The First Amendment clearly places the church outside the jurisdiction of the civil government. Quote, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion nor prohibiting the free exercise thereof, unquote. Religion cannot be free if you have to pay the government through taxation to exercise it. Since churches aren't taxable in the first place, why do so many of them go to the IRS and seek permission to be tax exempt? It occurs out of ignorance. We didn't know any better. Bandwagon logic. Everyone else is doing it. Professional advice. Many attorneys and CPAs recommend it. Does the law require or even encourage a church to organize as a 501c3? To answer that question, let's turn to what the IRS itself has to say. Now, in addition to reading the text in this website, I will provide a link to the IRS's source documents, so you can go to them and read them yourself and get it right from the horse's mouth what they have to say. If you want to go back and look at the two videos I made where I was recounting a dialogue I had via email with an elder at my church organization, You will see that I do cite the source IRS document to this elder. And keep in mind, this elder that I was having this dialogue with is a very kind-hearted, considerate, person who tries very hard, he and his wife, to do much good for many people. You must keep this in mind. So many of these people who are ensnared and entangled in this 501c3 corporate status, so many of these people do have good intentions, but good intentions do not equate with the righteousness of God. We must follow the word of the Bible. So churches need not apply. In order to be considered for tax-exempt status by the IRS, an organization must fill out and submit IRS Form 1023 and 1024. However, note what the IRS says regarding churches and church ministries in Publication 557. Some organizations are not required to file Form 1023. These include churches, interchurch organizations of local units of a church, conventions or associations of churches, or integrated auxiliaries of a church, such as men's or women's organizations, religious school, mission society, or youth group. These organizations are exempt automatically if they meet the requirements of Section 501c3. Churches are automatically tax exempt. According to IRS Code 508C1A, special rules with respect to Section 501c3 organizations. A. New organizations must notify secretary that they are applying for recognition of 501c3 status. C. Exceptions. 1. Mandatory exceptions. Subsections A and B shall not apply to A. Churches, their integrated auxiliaries, and conventions or associations of churches. This is referred to as the mandatory exception rule. Thus, we see from the IRS's own publications and the tax code that it is completely unnecessary for a church to apply for tax-exempt status. In the IRS's own words, a church is automatically tax-exempt. Churches are automatically tax-deductible. And what about tax deductibility? Doesn't church still need to become a 501c3 so that contributions to it can be taken as a tax deduction? The answer is no. According to IRS Publication 526, organizations that qualify to receive deductible contributions, you can deduct your contributions only if you make them to a qualified organization. To become a qualified organization, most organizations other than churches and governments, as described below, must apply to the IRS. In the IRS's own words, a church is automatically tax deductible. And I'm going to stop reading the bold print stuff because it's just redundant. So not only is it completely unnecessary for any church to seek 501c3 status, to do so becomes a grant of jurisdiction to the IRS by any church that obtains that state favor. In the words of Steve Nestor, IRS Senior Revenue Officer, now retired, quote, I am not the only IRS employee who's wondered why churches go to the government and seek permission to be exempted from a tax they didn't owe to begin with, and to seek a tax-deductible status that they've always had anyways. Many of us have marveled at how church leaders want to be regulated and controlled by an agency of government that most Americans have prayed would just get out of their lives. Churches are in an amazingly unique position, but they don't seem to know or appreciate the implications of what it would mean to be free of government control. And that is from the foreword of In Caesar's Grip by Peter Kershaw. Now, Peter Kershaw, if you type in his name with a K, Kershaw, you'll find he has lectures out there as well concerning 501c3 incorporation and all of that. Now, I am going to stop here. I'm not going to read anything from the 501c3 myths page today, but I'm going to take this and I am going to just bring it back around to what I was talking about at the beginning of the video concerning the damaging effects that it has on any church organization, or individual Christian to believe in such nonsense as preterism or futurism. I'm going to show you why. Something that is absolutely amazing to me is how even the futurists agree with the historicists on the messages to the seven churches of Asia Minor being messages to the ages of the church throughout the ages since the first century. I find that amazing. And yet, as soon as those messages are over, the futurists automatically fast forward to a rapture beginning at chapter 4, and then everything is out the window, because what does it matter to them? If you're a preterist or a futurist, what does this book have to do with you? It was either already all done, or most of it is yet to come, and it won't matter, right? Because you'll be raptured. See the fallacy there? The problem there? And how much we can learn from this book? Okay. So, Jesus is giving his messages to these churches. Ephesus first, Smyrna second. And we get to his message to the church of Pergamum. Now, you can do a word study on Pergamum, and you will find out that Pergamum denotes being married to power. Our Lord says, to the angel of the assembly in Pergamum write, he who has the sharp two-edged sword says these things. I know your works, and where you dwell, where Satan's throne is. You hold firmly to my name and didn't deny my faith in the days of Antipas, my witness, my faithful one, who was killed among you where Satan dwells. But I have a few things against you, because you have there some who hold the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to throw a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed to idols, and to commit sexual immorality. So you also have some who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans likewise. Repent, therefore, or else I'm coming to you quickly, and I will make war against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the assemblies. To him who overcomes, to him I will give of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone, and on the stone a new name written, which no one knows but he who receives it. In the 4th century, the Roman Empire was experiencing civil wars, generals, Caesars were vying for power, and it turned out that a pretender to the throne named Constantine, who was in the least a pragmatist and an opportunist, said that he experienced a spiritual conversion to the faith of Christianity. And he did things that, if we were to just simply compare what Constantine did, the beginning of the end in many ways. He did things that reverberate to this day. The Council of Nicaea, not the least of the things he did. And so we see that, well, for one thing, with the Council of Nicaea, we see hundreds of bishops who already, the structure that they were maintaining throughout their bishoprics were a structure not biblical. But the simple fact that these bishops authenticated Constantine's claim to have any sort of authority over the matters of the church was absolutely the beginning of the end. That there we see since the first century AD of this marriage between what was to be the pure, true church of Jesus Christ, becoming married to power. Jesus said, he said, I know your works and where you dwell, where Satan's throne is. And so thus, under the reign of Constantine, the church was centralized into Rome. He said that there are some among you who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to throw a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed to idols and commit sexual immorality. And so it happened that these bishops did this very same thing. And you also have some who hold to the teachings of the Nicolaitans to overcome the people. And how were they doing that? Through their system of hierarchical church clergy, their priest system, their bishop system, to have one bishop of a church as opposed to multiple elders who are charged to shepherd those people in good conscience, because when the chief shepherd appears, they will all answer for what they've done or what they haven't done. If we at a church, as a church, would not fail to remember history, then I think that we would more clearly understand the great problems and great evils that are bound to be repeated by such an unholy union with power. This union with power that the church did, not all of the church, but much of the church, did willingly with this Emperor Constantine, who I am sure at the time many had to be aware of how bogus his conversion was. Them going along with him and marrying themselves to power led to the emergence of that little horn of Daniel 7, who has sought to slaughter the saints of God for over a millennia. And he still to this day exists, causing strife, lies, deception, murder amongst the people of God in the papacy. If we would not fail to observe and understand the history of the church, then we would not fail so utterly to understand the words of Revelation 13. And starting in verse 11, John writes, "I saw another beast coming up out of the earth. He had two horns like a lamb, and he spoke like a dragon. He exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence. He makes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast, whose fatal wound was healed. He performs great signs, even making fire come down out of the sky to the earth in the sight of the people. He deceives my own people who dwell on the earth because of the signs he was granted to do in front of the beast, saying to those who dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast who had the sword wound and lived. It was given to him to give breath to it, to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as wouldn't worship the image of the beast to be killed. He causes all, the small and the great, the rich and the poor, and the free and the slave, to be given marks on their right hands or on their foreheads, and that no one would be able to buy or sell unless he had that mark, the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. He who has understanding, let him calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666. Now pay particular attention to verse 15, that it was given to him to give breath to it, to the image of the beast. So once again, after so many people resisted, fought against, and died for the purity of God's word, that Rome has hated over all these centuries, has hated, has tried to destroy and destroy those people who love it and read it. After all this, the amnesiac church today has once again willingly entered into a union with the state. And it doesn't end there. At a point, and I might as well just make it this point right now. I'll go down to 501c3. And let's just take a quick look at Executive Order 13397. This executive order was signed by George W. Bush in March 7th, 2006. It says, by the authority vested in me as president by the Constitution and the laws of the United States of America, and in order to help the federal government coordinate a national effort to expand opportunities for faith-based and other community organizations, and to strengthen their capacity to better meet America's social and community needs, it is hereby ordered as follows. Section 1. Establishment of a Center for Faith-Based and Community Initiatives at the Department of Homeland Security. A. The security of the Secretary of Homeland Security, Secretary, shall establish within the Department of Homeland Security, Department, a Center for Faith-Based and Community Initiatives. B. The center shall be supervised by a director appointed by secretary. The secretary shall consult with the director of the White House Office of Faith-Based and Community Initiatives, WHOFBCI director, prior to making such appointment. C. The department shall provide the center with a appropriate staff, administrative support, and other resources to meet its responsibilities under this order. D. The center shall begin operations no later than 45 days from the date of this order. Section 2. Purpose of the center. The purpose of the center shall be to coordinate agency efforts to eliminate regulatory, contracting, and other programmatic obstacles to the participation of faith-based and other community organizations in the provision of social and community services. They exist to do all things they can to break down the clear divide there ought be between the church and the state. Section 3, responsibilities of the Center for Faith-Based and Community Initiatives. In carrying out the purpose set forth in Section 2 of this order, the center shall A. conduct, in coordination with the WHOFBCI director, a department-wide audit to identify all existing barriers to the participation of faith-based and other community organizations in the delivery of social and community services by the department. Do you understand what's being said here? Because it took me a few readings. And one more time. Okay. A department-wide audit to identify all existing barriers to the participation of faith-based and other community organizations in the delivery of social and community services by the department, including but not limited to regulations, rules, orders, procurement, and other internal policies and practices and outreach activities that unlawfully discriminate against or otherwise discourage or disadvantage the participation of faith-based and other community organizations in federal programs. He's obliterating the lines between church and state. And any of you who does not realize the extent of wickedness in this current state and why there needs to be clear lines between the two, well, then you haven't been paying attention to anything. B, coordinate a comprehensive departmental effort to incorporate faith-based and other community organizations in department programs and initiatives to the greatest extent possible. What department? The Department of Homeland Security. Do you know what kind of stuff these people do? Do you know what kind of war they conduct on the citizens of America? Do you know how they consider people who are law-abiding, lawful, good, decent people who don't want to see their country ruined any more through the immorality that this wicked Jesuit Rome-backed government is pushing on all its people? They consider them the enemy. And they want to get rid of any and all barriers that yet still exist between the church and state. In fact, they say all faith-based organizations. C. Propose initiatives to remove barriers identified pursuant to Section 3A of this order, including but not limited to reform of regulations, procurement, and other internal policies and practices and outreach activities. D. Propose the development of innovative pilot and demonstration programs to increase the participation of faith-based and other community organizations in federal as well as state and local initiatives. And E. Develop and coordinate departmental outreach efforts to disseminate information more effectively to faith-based and other community organizations with respect to programming changes, contracting opportunities, and other agency initiatives, including but not limited to web and internet resources. Section 4, reporting requirements. A, report no later than 180 days from the date of this order and annually thereafter. The center shall prepare and submit a report to the WHO FBCI director. B. Contents. The report shall include a description of the department's efforts in carrying out its responsibilities under this order, including but not limited to I. A comprehensive analysis of the barriers to the full participation of faith-based and other community organizations in the delivery of social and community services identified to Section 3A of this order and the proposed strategy to eliminate those barriers, and two, a summary of the technical assistance and other information that will be available to faith-based and other community organizations regarding the program activities of the agency and the preparation of applications or proposal for grants, cooperative agreements, contracts, and procurement. C. Performance indicators. The first report shall include annual performance indicators and measurable objectives for departmental action. Each report filed thereafter shall measure the department's performance against the objectives set forth in the initial report. Section 5, responsibility of the secretary. The secretary shall designate an employee within the department to serve as the liaison to point of contact with the WHO FBCI director and cooperate with the WHO FBCI director to provide such information, support, and assistance to the WHO FBCI director as required to implement this order. General provisions, this order shall be implemented subject to the availability and appropriations to the extent permitted by law. This order is not intended to and does not create any right or benefit substantive or procedural enforceable at law or in equity by a party against the United States, its agencies or entities, its officers, employees, or agents, or any other person. Now, following this is an article by Nancy Levant. I will put a link in this. It's a very short article, and what she has to say is very powerful. Because she's right. She's absolutely right. And yes, I did go through, I wanted to read all of the text of that executive order. Now, first off, I don't believe that George W. Bush wrote that or most of his executive orders. I don't honestly see him as that intellectual. This guy signs the orders he's given. So, concerning Nancy Levant's editorial on this, July 25th, 2006, newswithviews.com. The separation of church and state, gone with the stroke of a pen, as of March 7th, 2006, our nation's leader signed another executive order which tied the Department of Homeland Security to our leader's faith-based churches. Okay, all you nonprofit churches out there, you now serve the federal government's primary spying agency. That is now your primary function. You are now and officially an organized den of thieves. I would feel sorry for the pastors, ministers, priests, and rabbis, except for the fact that I just can't and won't. How stupid and positively corrupt can you possibly be to take money in exchange for manipulating your flocks of idiot sheep to the national slaughter? And will you also spy on your flocks and provide reports to your new master? In exchange for money, have you agreed to pacify and organize your flocks in the event of a national emergency? You certainly have, for you have been ordered to do so. And have you been ordered to offer your buildings, your resources, and your labor forces called congregations to serve your newly declared administrator? I try to come up with words to describe how I feel about this executive order and the churches that have partnered themselves to this system. The words don't come, minus the fact that the church has completely and irreversibly fallen to the lowest and darkest common denominator, which is the total betrayal of the souls of the faithful. I would pray for your forgiveness, but I don't want to. Nor do I want to write about this sickening topic, but I appeal to Christian people to, one, ask your church leaders if they are faith-based funded, and two, to leave those churches and start home-based churches with your friends and family members. Do not support executive-ordered Department of Homeland Security churches with your presence or your money. You're being manipulated and reported upon, guaranteed. You are being told what to do when more crisis hits the nation and will hit the nation, as all is now planned down to our weather emergencies, which are providing the training and relocation exercises for the real crisis to come, the one that permanently collapses constitutional America. The church needs to regroup and gather in homes where faith is restored, private, and truth is real. Forget the church leadership. They are padding their pockets and socially re-engineering your mind with think tank religion and crisis management. And they're getting paid to do so, much like public schools and mass media. Raise your churches in your home. All you need is a Bible. One will do. Save yourselves and your souls and leave your new and improved church buildings, fancy organizations, fundraisers, and colorful windows behind. As in all communist countries, the church will survive underground, so to speak, and with genuine prayer, and serve your constitutional America. Don't give up on freedom, even as it dissolves before your eyes. Be courageous in truth and gather together in truth. Again and again, I strongly recommend that you contact ACE, Americans for Constitutional Enforcement, at contactus@a4ce.org, and request their information packet. Work to preserve your unalienable rights. There is no other choice but to fall, much like the American church. And please remember that faith-based churches are now governmental agencies. Just like public schools, mass media, and mass communications, nothing more and nothing less. ACE will help you, your family, and your neighbors to learn the truth about today's America. And what you don't know is allowing for the total destruction of your rights and your individual freedom. What you don't know is rapidly, rapidly destroying your country. Your continued ignorance is why we are falling. Please contact ACE right now. May God bless the American people. Nancy Levant. Okay, so, honestly, I think I'm going to go ahead and contact ACE, see what they have to say. But there it is. When we make decisions that are selfish decisions, and we have the ridiculous, unrealistic thought that it's not going to hurt anybody, when all of these pastors, these hirelings, decided that they wanted the extra, that what they had wasn't enough, and got themselves involved in 501c3 incorporation. This is what it inevitably led to. And so again, if anybody really thinks that Donald Trump is going to come in and bust this up, you're out of your mind. You're out of your mind. Just, okay, let's just consider what the government has invested in 501c3 status and this faith-based initiatives thing in conjunction with the Department of Homeland Security. Just consider what they have invested in that. And then consider that they murdered Kennedy, probably for less. This muzzle, this 501c3 muzzle, has been so instrumental in pushing forward the agenda of the New World Order, which is heartily backed by and pushed forward by those tentacles of Rome. Do you think they're going to give that up without a fight? It's not likely. If you consider the fact that it's been around for about 50 years, around the time of Lyndon Johnson, and then you consider how much our society in general has degraded since then, you will easily be able to see just the effects that the 501c3 muzzle has had on the church and on society. So, I'm going to encourage you to keep up the good fight. Do what you can. Do what you can to educate others. Because it's not easy. There's a lot of resistance out there. Believe me. The churches, they have walls up. They have walls up. Because the people who are making merchandise off the sheep, they don't want their racket to get busted up. The people who have little to no faith in God, that He will take very good care of them if they will just do the right thing and obey Him, have got walls up, and they have a guilty conscience, and they don't want to admit that. They don't want to stand up. They don't want to stand up and be men. Get a job. And once you get that job, then you can find out. You can find out where the Lord is calling you. And people that go into Bible college after high school or whatever else, so many of them do it for all the wrong reasons. So many of them find out after they've already invested, or somebody else has invested, that kind of money, and they've invested that kind of time to get that degree. They find out after that that's not their calling. They're not sure that they even really want to do that, or that they're even suited to do it. But that's the only way that they think they can support their oftentimes large families. These guys do not hold back on having children. I think we can all agree on that. Let's keep it real. These professional pastors oftentimes have very large families. So there is a lot of resistance out there. And it's sad. It's sad. Are many of them just not seeing the truth? Maybe. Do many of them understand the truth and suppress it in unrighteousness? I believe so. Do all of them? Probably not. But is any of this glorifying to the head of their church, Jesus Christ, not the IRS? Well, if you're a 501c3, technically the IRS is the head of the church, not Jesus, but you're getting my point. It's a sad state of affairs. If we would just learn from history, and we would just understand what that image is of that beast. We can fast forward a little bit, go to Revelation 18, and look at the woman who rides the beast. There's a woman riding the beast. And what's going to happen to her? What she's called? Doesn't sound pleasant at all. What's going to happen? And I think there's going to be plenty of persecution towards the truth, towards the saints who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus Christ. But just remember that the sufferings of this life are not even worthy to be considered when understanding the reality of eternal life that we have in Christ Jesus our Lord. So until next time, I'd like to remind you all that Jesus is Lord. God's kingdom is forever. And I'm your servant. Farewell.